next book about, which is called We Who Wrestle with God. And I suppose this lecture is a preview of that, of the ideas in that book. We characterize that which must exist at the pinnacle of the hierarchy of attentional prioritization with the characterization of the divine in narrative. You might say, well, what's divine? Well, we could define it technically. Divine is that which is deepest. What's deepest? That which most other things depend on. That's a good definition of depth. A deep and profound piece of literature, Milton, is the foundation stone for many branches of literature. There's many literary products you can't understand without understanding Milton. And you can't understand Milton without understanding the biblical corpus, which is even deeper and in that sense more profound, given the metaphoric relationship between the idea of profundity and depth. And why is the biblical corpus deep? Well, it's an attempt to flesh out, using narrative characterization, the nature of the spirit that has to inhabit the highest place in the hierarchy of attentional and action priority. And so why would I say spirit? Well, because it's an embodied, it's something embodied. It's not a description of the world. It's a pattern you enact and embody. And so when you're called to God and the Logos through the biblical corpus, you're called to allow yourself to be possessed by the spirit that represents the union of awe-inspiring, imitatable virtues. And then you might say, well, what are those? And I can walk through some of them just so you get a sense of this. I don't want to do it exhaustively. In the opening chapters of Genesis, which is where the idea of the Logos is highlighted above all else in some real sense, you have this notion that whatever God is uses whatever the Logos is to extract habitable order from potential. And the tohu vabohu, that's the chaos, is a weird intermingling in the linguistic sense of chaotic possibility of the world per se with confusion and psychological disorientation. And so it's an amalgam, that chaos. And it's the chaos you feel when a plenitude of possibilities opens up in front of you, which is destabilizing and psychologically challenging, especially if the purview of possibility is beyond your ability to contend with. But you can see the massive possibility conjoined with a sense of anxiety. That's too much possibility. To bring order to that, you cast your attention upon it and you prioritize it, and God imposes a benevolent order upon that chaotic possibility, extracts from that chaotic possibility the habitable order that is good. And the reason that the habitable order that's extracted is good is because God uses the Logos, which is something like a combination of orientation towards the highest possible good, which you could think of as love, and truth. And one way of characterizing the imitatable manifestation of the Logos is that it's the nexus of love and truth. And I think it's truth embodied in love, or embedded in love, with love being superordinate. But that's a partial description, and it's disembodied and abstract in some sense, and doesn't have the grip necessary to compel you to act, to imitate. And so what you see in the biblical corpus are continual representations of the spirit that must occupy the highest place in the hierarchy of imitable, mimicable action as a pattern that possesses your perceptions and actions and calls you into the world. And so, for example, in the story of Adam and Eve, once Adam and Eve are thrown out of the garden because they become prematurely self-conscious and prideful in some real sense, God is presented as the spirit that you walk with when you walk unself-consciously in relationship to the highest in the garden. And that's actually an experiential reference. As you imagine, you're having a particularly good day in a particularly beautiful garden, like the day we had today. It's like, are you closer to God? Well, the answer is, experientially, well, yes, because you feel that your existence is imbued with a deep sense of appropriate significance. And that's not a rational, secondarily derived argument. It's primary. It's a primary experience. And part of what the biblical corpus is trying to do is to lay out the nature of the spirit that inhabits you when you're oriented towards the highest possible good, and to point out that that's phenomenological, it's experiential, it's existential, it's embodied. It's not a secondary overlay of the description of the nature of the world on the world. That's not what the biblical corpus is trying to do. So in the story of Cain and Abel, what's God? God is that which calls you to make the appropriate sacrifices and calls you on it when you don't. And try to escape that and see what happens. We know perfectly well, that that's a pathway to hell. And you might say, I don't believe in hell. And I would say, that means you don't know anything. Noah, who is God, or what is God in the story of Noah? The spirit that calls the wise to prepare in the face of crisis. Do you abide by that or not? Well, you do if you're wise, and you do if you care about the people around you. Abraham, what's God? The spirit that calls the inappropriately luxuriating out to the terrible adventure of their life, and that then requires of them the highest possible sacrifice to obtain the highest possible goal. In Exodus, what's God? The spirit that lays tyranny to waste. The spirit that guides you through the desert of the soul. The spirit that orients you towards the promised land and imbues you with the enthusiasm that allows you to make your way out of the tyranny and through the desert. And so on. And each story is part of a circumambulation, a narrative circumambulation, that's attempting to represent the union of virtues that could be embodied in perception and action that constitute the pinnacle of the pyramid. And that, by the way, pyramid, that's Mount Sinai. That's the proper hierarchical organization of society. That's the aesthetic model for the construction of the Ark of the Covenant. It's all of that simultaneously. It's the Egyptian pyramid with the gold cap. The question is, what's the cap? What's at the highest? Well, that is the mystery. What should be placed in the highest place? We already said, well, something better be, because if nothing's placed in the highest place, then there's nothing in the highest place. And what's the consequence of that? Well, to return to that theme, anomy, anxiety, overwhelming dread, psychological destabilization, and the absence of joy. And there is no escaping from that except by solving the problem. But it's worse than that, because this hierarchy of perceptual prioritization unites us socially. So here we are in a theater.